Speaks. Thanks for joining me today. This is Deanna Spingola, and I'm coming to you from the suburbs of Chicago. In a so-called democracy, the ruling class does not use police force to control the population. Rather, it uses mind control. My guest today, Stephen Jacobson, wrote the following on his website, mindcontrolinamerica.com, and I quote, "Most people do not pay conscious attention to the things that affect them subconsciously. They do not usually know what to look for. However, when pointed to, these things can be recognized and understood. Psychological warfare and economic warfare are being waged against America. Mind control is the most important issue facing America and the world. The most effective way to protect yourself and your loved ones from subconscious manipulation is by being aware of how it works. The population is being conditioned by a mass media-created culture. Long-term exposure to this artificial reality cannot help but have an enormous impact on the social and political life of our nation. Entertainment is not value-free." My guest today is Stephen Jacobson. His website is Mind Control in America. Stephen, welcome to the program.
Thank you, Deanna. It's my pleasure to be with you again.
Now, you worked in the film industry for 13 years you worked in the film industry and you did contract work for a Washington, D.C. institution, and you recut films, and so you became quite aware of what was going on. You knew how to edit films, and you could see from this, plus your education, plus the influence that your father had on you, that things weren't quite like what they were being portrayed, right?
Yes, that is correct. In fact, that observation goes back even further. Goes back to even before I had studied film at Boston University, before I even knew that I was going to have an interest in that area. It goes back to when I was a child. I had questions. I didn't understand the world I found myself in. I can remember back 5 years old, looking around this strange place and this world, and I didn't understand what was going on. And I go into the public education system, and I still didn't understand. And the question I had for myself was, how do I know that what I'm being told is true?
Exactly.
And yet, your grades depend on your ability to give back what you have received, and that determines your academic your academic history and your ability to earn a living later on.
Right. Hold that thought. We will be right back after a word from our sponsors. Welcome back, friends. My guest today is Stephen Jacobson. His website is mindcontrolinamerica.com. Now, Stephen, you were talking about your experience in school and that you had questions even as a five-year-old, but I think a lot of people don't, because they view school and teachers as credible. Teachers are authoritarian figures that you should believe, and so people do give back the same information that they've been fed in order to get the A's and to get a piece of paper that tells them that they can participate in a certain occupation. Correct?
That is absolutely correct. But my circumstance was something didn't fit. I felt that, and I was very uneasy about it. I felt that there was something wrong with me because I didn't understand. And so, but I did have a faith that someday I would, and that sustained me through public education, through college. As I said earlier, I studied film at Boston University. But when I get out into the workplace, and I still have the same issues, same questions. Now, working in the film industry, and I worked in a number of capacities, cameraman, production manager, editor, heavy background in editing. And that's where a film is pretty much made in the cutting room. And so I was very well aware of how plastic and moldable media reality is from that experience, and how easy it is to change the meaning of an event or change the meaning of what someone says through simple editing. But in spite of knowing that, I did not fully appreciate the extent to which we are all manipulated and controlled by media, including the people who work in it, until I was given the results of private medical research investigating programming and deprogramming. And when I received that material, I studied it, I saw the implications, and that opened up my eyes to see more clearly that something else was going on here that helped me see a bigger picture. Now, this happened in 1980. I was working in New York City at the time as a film editor for a production distribution company for theatrical films. And my background, I had done before going to New York City, I was working as an independent filmmaker, doing sales films, educational films, pretty much a one-man operation, or hiring people to assist a sound man if I needed people on the crew. Then going into New York City and working first for a documentary company, doing contract work for a film institute in Washington, and then joining a production distribution company for theatrical films. And it's when I received the research, and my father was trained as a hypnotist. He worked as a hypnotherapist, a counselor, and a researcher. He was a consultant to the medical profession for more than 20 years, and he was working with doctors. And over a period of 11 years, the initial research that he did led to the development of an audio that at one time doctors wrote prescriptions for their patients to have this audio to aid in the treatment of different health problems. Physical problems, emotional problems, psychological problems. The audio is called personal comfort training. And one day while I was working, this is in 1980, my father called. He wanted to see me and went to see him. At the time, he was having some health issues himself. And I knew about the research, but we had talked about it before, but he wanted to meet with me and go into it more, in greater detail, and to ask me if I wanted to pick up on it and continue with it. And I said yes. I saw the implications, and so I went back to New York City with the research materials and started studying them, using the audio on myself. The audio was an aid to all health problems. Stem from stress, anxiety, tension. They are major factors in all health issues. Worry, stress, anxiety, tension affect everyone. And that affects us physically, emotionally. If we're not comfortable and at peace within ourselves, it's also going to affect how we perceive the world around us. If we're all stressed out all the time, not only is it going to affect us physically, but we're not going to see things that are happening right in front of us that we would see if we were in a more relaxed state. So the audio was a retraining audio for the patient or subject to listen to on a regular basis and to relearn what comes very natural to us as children, and that is how to be comfortable and relaxed. And that affects a breathing apparatus, a capacity for breathing. Most people breathe very shallowly and are not using a full breathing apparatus. This is retraining to help increase that capacity to get more oxygen through the system and facilitate health. Healthy functioning physically, emotionally, psychologically, because there's the verbal content is a It's a deep programming, reprogramming program to that over a period of time dissolves, dissipates the negative conditioning and programming that we have accumulated throughout our life, and reprograms us for health. It's soliciting the aid of the subconscious to facilitate this process, and doctors were writing prescriptions for the patients to use it for pain management where drugs were not helping, for people with respiratory ailments, asthma, emphysema, who had people who only had one lung, to aid in increasing the capacity to get more oxygen to their body.
It's the brain.
So mm-hmm. It's a multi-purpose kind of audio, and that led to my investigating the mind control issue.
Right, and it is pervasive in mind control. In fact, it's quite formalized. When the government created the Psychological Strategy Board, which basically had two major purposes, was to legitimize and institutionalize peacetime propaganda. And so it isn't something that just kind of happened spontaneously. It was deliberate.
Oh, absolutely, because inducing stress, anxiety, fear, tension in a population is a strategy of psychological warfare, because people, when they're subjected to intense stress over a prolonged period of time, their thinking and behavior is going to be altered, and they're going to be, in that state, people are more highly suggestible and subject to manipulation more so than at any other time. So certainly important for everyone's lifestyle to learn, relearn how to be comfortable no matter what is going on around us. And so that, and at the same time when I got this research material, people were always giving my father information, sharing things with him, because he wasn't always charging for his services. If a patient couldn't pay, he was still going to help work with them, because in many cases the patients that these physicians were sending to him were people that they had given up on. They couldn't help, and my father mm-hmm. was able to help them in training them with the personal comfort training audio, and then with his counseling services. But someone had given him two books, and my father gave them to me. He thought I would be interested, and he knew, rightly so, that I would be. One of them was a very small booklet called The Occult Technology of Power. And the other one was the one you and many of your listeners are probably familiar with, Gary Allen's None Dare Call It Conspiracy. I read these two books. I went through the bibliography and started ordering books, started looking for alternative sources of information on all kinds of subjects, politics, economics, history, psychology, religion, you name it. I was looking to see what was out there and to get just to do a survey, to get a fix on what information is available that I didn't have access to when I was going to school. And what we normally don't have access to unless we find out about some of these alternative resources. And so that's
sure.
where it began, to investigate this whole issue of mind control and mental manipulation, because, one, it was helping me to resolve some of the issues I had for myself regarding understanding what was going on out here. And then I wanted to take the training and the skills that I had developed through going to school and in the workplace, and produce summary information that would be helpful to other people who either didn't have the time or the inclination to do the homework themselves, and to make this information available for more people. And so that's how the Mind Control in America audio series came about.